Hope to change his way.
That was a beautiful ult by Elite Aussie. I don't know if you saw it, but he stunned almost Old Chank's side, but it's just not enough without damage follow-up. I'd like to see more delaying heroes out of OCE Gaming, maybe like a Tracer or a D.Va, just so they can stop his payload for as long as possible.
And another great Doppelstein there at the end, grabbed three of them in it, and that basically eliminated any chance of OCE Gaming holding that.
Yeah, the player to watch seems to be Scaro. He's just getting pick after pick after pick, and I think that's what's contributed to Chunker winning this fight.
I think the other thing worth noting is, part of me feels like OC Gaming doesn't actually know how Zarya works. And what I mean is, it always feels like Zarya is fully charged. I don't know whether that's just because of the really great bubble game, and definitely give Landlord credit. He's had some great bubbling to keep his team alive, but he's also always been in that 70 to 100 charge range. And I mean, that's just feeding damage coming in at you.
Yeah, it's players like that which allow players like Scaro to really have this room to move. I mean, a good Zarya that can bubble well keeps a McCree alive for so much longer. McCree only has 200 health like any other DPS. So you really have to keep him alive with the damage that he can output. But at the moment, Chunk is doing a good job. I think generally he was dying towards the end of a fight, if he was dying at all. And that's what you really want out of your DPS players. You want them outputting damage but still staying alive. And I think Scaro is doing a good job of that, and T'Chunka as a whole.
And I'm just flying around here. It looks like the official time is 6:16 to beat. So OCE Gaming has a task in for them.
Yeah, I think it's a beatable time, but at the same time, it's a defendable time. It's one of those times where you really have to show up. Like, sometimes you see teams get a really long time and you can kind of just like, you know, kind of half effort your way through the whole map. But with a time like this, both teams really have to bring their A game if they want to win the map. And that's what I'm excited to see. I mean, Human Radio playing a Genji, I think Genji can do a lot of work on Nubani. There's a lot of flank paths. And Harpy's still playing that Pharah. I'm, to be honest, surprised that he hasn't been shut down more. Because, I mean, even looking at the current comp of OCE Gaming, a Soldier and a Genji, neither of those are very nice for a Pharah to deal with. So I will be surprised if Papi continues to dominate. I mean, it happened last half though, so you never know.
Hello, did I lag out or did you? You went silent in the middle of a word. Am I alone? Friends?
I'm still here.
Oh, there we go. Sorry. Everything went silent for me for a minute. We have the Genji here to try and counter that McCree. But the opening push is coming in. It's the up top play again. But a great pin from Landlord grabs the 76, and he's just in behind there as Reinhardt. Harpy grabs the other Reinhardt as well. Scaro picks up Zarya, and it's all to Janka here. And this opening hold could be absolutely everything that they need. Just one stop puts such an onus on to OCE Gaming to really try and do anything. And it's going to be a hard task for them to do it.
One thing I did notice from that fight though is Human Radio got out alive. I'm seeing some very nice Genji maneuverability there, and that's what you need from a Genji. Once he gets his ultimate, his Dragon Blade, which he almost has, if you use that maneuverability, you can take down entire teams if they don't respond appropriately. Behind you.
Here comes the opening charge in from the Reinhardt. Human Radio picks up Landlord, so that is no defensive Reinhardt. This is a good start, but they gotta pick Scaro as he grabs the 76. He's doing all kinds of work here, still on McCree. Hobbit down is going to nerf this defense heavily, and now with no Wither and no Scaro, this should be point one, unless Scaro can do something incredible. Well, he's been alive for a very long time, but the incredible does not happen.
I think the Landlord here is going to try and contest. I'm not really sure about that. As I mentioned before, generally you want to set up properly rather than opting for a longer delay. I really don't like it when teams try and delay the point like this, because generally the end result is a weaker defense on the following portions of the map. But, I mean, I talked about that Genji, and Genji did some real work last fight, so I think Tachanka really need to respond to that Genji. They need to be shutting it down quickly. I mean, we've seen Skaro's quality, the Kree. Kree can shut down a Genji, especially the new Kree, because you no longer need to rely on the right click with the left click damage being so good, so should be able to shut it down.
Push is starting to come forward, and they're just slowly pressuring it back. Now the ults are coming out here on all sides. High noon, break it down. He boosted, Skaro grabs Skipify. That's the Lucio down from the offense. It's a good start to the linchpin. Landlord on Deagon is pretty crucial, and it's Elite Ozzy grabbing 2, 3, but only 5. And the double double speed. It's a double picnic there. Defense, but the other revive now is going to keep this offensive push alive.
Yeah, that was a beautiful revive. I mean, we saw players go down and suddenly the Mercy's there. You really need to be eliminating that Mercy.
He is on fire here. He's just opened up the entire space, and with 3 minutes and 10 seconds, OCE Gaming actually has a realistic chance at this.
Yeah, I was really liking that ult he did. Caught Skaro, and as we've seen, Skaro's been the one getting those opening picks. If you can shut him down quickly with a stun like Elite Ozzy did, and then the Toblestein caught him, then you can really stop Tachanka's pick potential.
Well, and like, Skaro, you just as you were speaking about him, he happened to pick off Deadly Bits, the offensive Zarya. So that is a good opening pick. The defensive ults are up here, and I'm curious to see what Carpi will be able to do with his. That is the justice that will rain from above.
Yeah, it's a very good, especially if Scarf can get his Toblestein, and then if you combo those two together, if Elite Ozzy doesn't have his shield especially, you can wipe the whole team if used correctly, so if they combo it right, they should be able to do it. Human Radio is right in the middle of them.
Hopefully our sound situation gets sorted out here while we're at it. People still play about no sound, but here comes the ult. Elite Ozzy grabbed 2, but Carpi with the raining from above actually managed to grab 2 there. Breaking it down on the offensive side as they're feeling the heat. They have 2 minutes to do this. Really not getting the pick. Landlord going down to Elite Dust is the great first opening pick. Here come the ult. All kinds of Genji running right in there. It's the McCree though. Skaro grabbing 3. No revive on the offense. It's the defensive revive that's going to come in here. And that could actually be game changing. We're under 2 minutes.
Yeah, good use of revives. I mean, we saw the revive come into play when getting the second checkpoint. Now we see the defensive revive stop them getting the third. Mercy revives are so pivotal still. I mean, even though some players have been saying, yeah, maybe other supports are viable now, Mercy's revive is still so key. If you don't shut down their Mercy, you can bring a whole team back up. Especially if teams die together, which good teams do. You really want to be shutting that down. But Genji has the potential to shut down the Mercy in the back line.
Honestly, one of the most tilting things is, in fact, that Mercy revive just wiping out all your progress. Skarth grabs Elite Ozzy, and it's gamified. Lucio taken out by the charge. We are under a minute, and Landlord is going nuts. He and Skaro grab 2 more, and that, the revive. This is the last gasp of a revive. This needs to be so huge out of OC Gaming if they want to stand a chance. They have 45 seconds to hit the promised land. They really don't have position to even do it, or the ultimates.
Yeah, so many ults up for the defensive side. 4, almost 5. It's gonna be very hard to push into that for the OCE game. I think at this moment, Chunk has supreme advantage, but I could be wrong.
Yeah, this is... We're in 20, 19, 18. The defensive break it down's coming out here. 15 seconds, 14. The Toblestein, this has to be game. It's absolutely and defensive revive comes out there. I see 5 seconds on the clock. 3, 2, and 1.
It was a good push from OCE Gaming, but really that last fight, it was just too much going the way of Tachanka for that fight to be winnable. I mean, you've got to be a very strong pushing team if you want to get past 5 ultimates from the defensive side. And they were all used in that fight, which shows how pivotal they were.
Yeah, I mean, just like I said, it honestly, to me, came down to that really early first hold. The fact that OCE Gaming, when they were on defense, gave up first point on the very first push out of Tachanka. But Tachanka managed to hold. Was absolutely the difference maker in this game. Drop the beat.
But Landlord once again with a beautiful ultimate.
Hey, and that also brings me to one of the weirdest things I've ever experienced as a spectator. As because I guess I'm on a team with one of the Lucios as a spectator. As the break it down came, my cam movement speed also broke it down with the Lucio speed buff. So it was quite odd experience there, but you know.
Might have to submit a bug report to Blizzard after that one.
Yeah, though you love it, we're not only just casting a game, we're coming up with bugs. Oshi Gaming will get the good feeling cap to end the game. That is just the moral win there.
Play of the game. Human Radio did some good work on Genji, and I think if they had kept that point quicker, he could have really won the game for his team.
Yeah, just like look at this Genji, like the mid-air swipe on the Pharah, like that's just dirty.
But then I think we saw the ult come out at the end, and that's those ultimates. They can really just all your good work you do as a DPS, suddenly the Mercy just undoes it all, and it's just hardening. Epic.
And we see Elite Aussie get ranked up as his team's MVP. He really was so influential in that final push. In like that entire offense at the end, he was doing so much work, but he couldn't actually pull it off.
Slightly yeah, respect to Landlord as well. Both those Reinhardts, both Elite Aussie and Landlord, doing great work for their team, getting some really nice stuns. And that's what you want from tank players. You want them setting up their DPS players to be able to succeed. And I think Elite Aussie did that and Landlord did that. And I'm really glad that we're seeing this, even though these teams may not necessarily be the best teams in the region, that it's good that their tank players can enable their DPS players to do work. I mean, and we've seen that they have skill. I mean, Skaro getting picks, Human Radio's Genji getting picks. So when those tanks enable that, it really just makes things so much easier for the DPS players.
Well, and I'm curious to see if that is the status quo here, because we're going into another map. It's not just this map. This isn't the only one. We are now moving from Nubani to Gibraltar. I shouldn't say we're moving right this second, but that's where we will be headed.
Yeah, Gibraltar's an interesting map. I don't like it. Other people do. I think it's a map which favors people that are good at long-range battles. So if someone on one of these teams is good at a Widow, I think I've seen Skaro do very well in a Widow before. If you can combo that, I think I saw one team, I think it was Quintium, combo that with a Zenyatta. So Zenyatta would Discord a target, then Widow would hit them. That negates some of the nerfs Widow's received, and it can really allow for some really early picks, which, especially on the defensive side, are really pivotal.
Yeah, and personally, like, I know people are going to be like, damn that Dreamboat, how can he be a filthy Widow main? I do play Widow, and this is honestly one of my favorite maps. For that reason, it's got great sight lines. One of my favorite things to do is kind of dance around the spaceship airplane, you know, where there's that health pack.
I hate Widows that point. Do that.
Yeah, I never actually thought of that as a spot until I played against, like, it's very rare I find that I come across a Widow that just makes me like tip my cap and say, damn, this guy's good. But I played against when he did that, and I'm like, damn, this guy's good. And this is a really cool spot. So I started using it, and now everybody hates me. I'm just a filthy Widow main. But it is one of the things I love about this map, is there are some great little spots you can play, gimmicky spots. You can occasionally catch people out with some good one-offs as a Reaper or a 76 or something. Some good spam lines. So this is honestly probably my favorite map to play. At least I feel... When I personally go off, this is usually the map I do it on, at least as of late. So, but and it was also the very first map I played in beta. I didn't know what I was doing, but it was that, the first map.
The first map experience. I can't actually remember what mine is because I have a terrible memory. But there's just something about those first moments in every game. I still remember the first map I played in Counter-Strike Global Offensive. I don't know if you're familiar with the game, but it's one of the arms race maps, and I still remember it from
way,
beta.
Way too much money invested in skins in that game. Way too much money. Fortunately, I don't have too much money invested in skins in this game. That's a good thing. I heard
Valve's shutting down the skin betting, which should be interesting, because a lot of players have a lot of money invested in skins and skin betting. So it's interesting. I'm wondering whether those players are going to get their money back from those skin betting sites.
I believe betting sites are mandated to require cash out. And as for there's some people in Counter-Strike who are just thinking like, oh my god, all the skin value is just going to crash to the nothing's going to be valuable anymore. I don't know how much you know about me personally. I come from a TF2 background, and that game has no gambling and a lot, and everything still has really high value. So I do think it will stabilize. But that's enough about Valve Source games. We're casting Blizzard games, and it looks like we're ready to go to Watchpoint Gibraltar. Are you excited?
I'm excited.
Can you just not hide it?
Arriving at
yep.
Watchpoint Gibraltar.
Cool. That's what I am. As we are moving to this like lighthouse in water, and I will say one thing I do love that Blizzard's done is these maps are super unique and, you know, pretty. Like, I like the fact that we're going to a map that is just like cut out of a mountain. It's something special. As I'm looking at this horizon hallway, looking out of this window, I see a Tracer face and a Reinhardt. That's just spectacular.
And that coastline, oh, it's beautiful. That looks like a sea you'd want to swim in. Like going out to that lighthouse. I mean, it'd probably be pretty deep, I imagine. But I mean, it looks nice, doesn't it?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know what swimming is. I'm Canadian. All our water is ice. I'm kidding. I live in like the place where it never snows in Canada, like the only one.
Is it even Canada if it doesn't snow?
It rains a lot, so I think that counts.
It sounds more like New Zealand. Canada's both raining a lot. Nothing's gonna stop me. We get a lot of rain.
Yeah, you know, it's. I'm basically in the Seattle of Canada. Actually, Vancouver is basically the Seattle of Canada, and we're like the prettier one. Like, we got all the flowers and stuff. So shout out to Victoria, all my peeps back home watching that. Like, nobody. But I do see some Canadians in chat, so I want to give you guys a wave.
Shut down for a reason.
Thank you for tuning
Maybe
in.
It's best it stays.
What I've noticed straight away is Human Radio is opting for a Pharah. I mean, like, this whole time I've basically been trash talking Pharah on the new patch, and we've seen it a lot. I think we've seen it every half so far, so I want to see how this does, because I want to be proven right about Pharah's weakness.
And I'm waiting for it, because I just feel like Skaro is about to just absolutely deny it. And it's a good sign here, doing a lot of damage. And this offensive ult already starting to get a cripple away here from OCE Gaming. As this card, like, it's below them. They've gotten a lot of distance, Tachanka has. And it's Human Radio, as I kind of predicted, being picked off by Skaro to open things off.
Yeah, I always love it when I'm proven right. It just makes me feel so nice as a color commentator.
It's Skaro grabbing Zarya as well. And again, in the high noon, it'll grab two, Gipsfight and Skelly. That's the Lucio and Mercy. There's no healing here. Skaro, once again, picking up where he left off, going absolutely mental.
Yeah, Skaro is such a great player. I've had the privilege of playing a bit I think it was Quick Match back before Ranked, and he's a quality player. I think his Widow carried me plenty of time. So I want to see if he Widows on the defensive half. That's what I'm waiting for, because if he brings his power, which he's been having with Kree, to Widow, I think he can get a lot of picks.
He might even keep going with the McCree at this rate. He's doing so great with it. And again, I just want to say, look at Landlord. What do you see on him? That is a fully charged Zarya. Now the ult's coming out here. But he's, again, doing so much damage on Zarya. They're feeding so much charge to him that, like, his defense is just crippling. Because, I mean, fully charged Zarya. What are you going to do there? Now the high moon's coming in here. They do break it down, so it won't actually grab anything, but Skaro still just kind of around this corner here, doing a lot of work. A great hammer down from Elite Ozzy grabs two of them, and it will pick up the Mercy. As Human Radio getting a couple of the picks.
Yeah, for all of
Hold
the
on.
Strength.
Hold on, Skaro. He just got pistoled down by Skelly Bones. That's a Mercy picking
that's
up the
embarrassing.
You can't do that!
Come on, Skaro, pick up your game. as you I was saying, Tachanka really haven't been focusing down the mercy of OCE Gaming well enough. Skellybones has been staying alive way too much. If you want to be winning those fights, you really got to focus down mercy at this stage of the game when you know mercy will have res. And the tanks did have an opportunity. I mean, obviously they don't have the vision of players that I do since I have X-ray vision. But that mercy was within reach of the Winston and the Zarya. And I think Human Radio just wasted his ult in the shuttle. Not going
to
be good.
I think he was trying to put down his spray and he ulted. As the poor bastard. But now it's the double double team. And we got all kinds of breaks coming out here. Landlord once again rocking the high charge, getting about three of them. But it's the defense coming out here. The revive. Can they keep going? And they actually, Scaro picks off two more. Landlord grabs Elite Ozzy. And this defense finally has been broken as Tachanka moving forward once again should get this checkpoint fairly easily. Although Deadly Bits running in. And should just become dead bits now. Yeah, that's what's happening. Scaro actually picked up Gimpify. That's the Lucio down as well. I missed that. I'm not entirely sure where Scaro was, but that's a nice little pick for him to have found.
Scaro's just being Scaro. He finds picks. I think it's just magic at this point.
He might be joining you on Team X-Ray Vision at this rate, man. Some of those picks are just like, wow. He's being spectacular. He's my MVP of the game so far. That for sure. The defensive break it down coming out here. Offensive one hasn't even come down, and the high noon comes down. It does not grab anybody. The Reinhardt shield of Elite Ozzy doing great work again.
I'm wondering if Scaro knew that you can just cancel that high noon. It seems like he just used it to cancel it, whereas you can get half the ult charge back if you cancel it, so I think that would have been the better option.
I feel like he might have just been trying to like bait it out, see how long it can get, and well, Parfy, he used the tactical visor, grabbed three of them there, Scaro grabbing two. So, bad high noon aside, the Jenk is doing all kinds of work right now. And Scaro still grabbing more, grabs the lead Ozzy, and now they're being, it's the spawn camp of OCE Gaming. This should easily be the round. They can't get out, and it's the other high noon. And it only grabs Nizgao and Nizagu.
Once again, Skellybone's resurrection.
Res game on point, but it's the Tobos team is collapsing everybody in here. Parfy and Scaro grab three of them combined. And they're still looking for more. Elite Ozzy somehow alive, but Scaro grabs the Mercy and Elite Ozzy, and that's the game. Or, well, a half. You know what I mean.
Yeah, what I have to credit Parfy with is he finally listened to me, not that he can hear me, and switched off Pharah. I think the Soldier has been getting so much work done, and I think the Kree Soldier is a very strong combo.
Well, let's just give a mental shout out to this revive here out of Hobbit. Really good play. Got a couple kill assists there. At least I'm expecting this to be the revive. So he grabbed a couple kill assists, and then he rezzes to kind of... That was where they finally broke that defense. And that led to an incredible 452 time out of Tachanka.
That's a pretty fast time for Gibraltar. If I'm correct, it's an 11-minute max map. Which means that... Or either that or it's 10, but either way, that's less than half of the available time. And that's going to be hard to beat. Especially if Scaro can jump on that Widow like I'm desperately wanting him to.
Well, I mean, he's been doing a lot of work as McCree. We could actually see him, dare I say it, shit the bed if he went to Widowmaker. And it looks like he's just going to roll with the punches and keep going with what's working for him as he is up on the McCree man.
Yeah, I like the Kree Soldier defense. If we see something like the Genji from Human Radio, we should be able to see the double hit scan be able to shut that down. The advantage of hit scan heroes is you can shut down high mobility heroes as long as you have the aim for it. And that's what I think is so strong about it. The Genji is still a strong pick, because if he can get his ultimate and not get shut down, you can wipe teams with Genji. It's honestly crazy the amount of work a good Genji can do. But I'm hoping that the combined power of Scaro and Parfy, both good players, can shut that down. Because if you can shut down that Genji early, the fights will be easy to win. But if you can't shut him down, the fights will be easy to lose.
Well, and I'm mildly entertained here in spawn. Nizagu is just trying to get this chalkboard spinning really fast. He's trying to do it by punching it, and it just wasn't working for him, so he just gave up and started shooting. But it was just kind of like, you remember that, like, non-athletic kid who was just trying to, like, spin something really quickly, and he just, like, lose it really fast, and he just, like, couldn't catch up with how fast he was spinning it? It was kind of like that. He was just doing it really, really slowly, and it was just a giant embarrassment for him. But he finally went to the gun and got it spinning well, as we are about ready to go here. Now! The doors have opened. Let's go. Certain, again, it's that up top hole coming out of Tachinki here. Mirroring the one from Osh Gaming. But they're already putting so much more offensive pressure compared to what OC had before that. And they actually grabbed Skelly. Burrow doing all kinds of work once again. Though Reinhardt's not going to be great for the defense. But still, like, it's enough delay tactics here that they're going to make this 452 time really hard to beat. Wither the Lucio, I think, fell down there.
Yeah, I think he was planning on the team jumping down as a group, and some just miscommunication there, I think, is what happened.
Fortunately, I don't think it's a bad enough miscue that it will cost them. That's because they're doing, again, a really good job of defending here. Landlord, especially, just kind of jumping forward, hopping back. No move. But look at this. Both of these Reinhardts are so far in behind. And Skarko grabbing Skelly means no revive. It feels like Skellybone's head is just being, like, a target for McCree. Being about four times the size it should have been. The double attack visors are coming out here. Nezahgu will stuff Harpies. And Nezahgu will grab a Hobbit. However, Hobbit didn't revive. And now a Tobolstein on the offense. This hold is still good enough, though, because the break is down to delaying here. Down to 3.5 minutes left.
Yeah, what they're trying to do here is just cut down as much of that time as possible. Stopwatch is all about who can delay the longest. Because realistically, when two good teams face, they both should be able to complete the map. What matters is the time you're completing it in. And I think T'Chunk is doing a good job of delaying, but they've now pushed back. They're going to get a solid hold in, which I like. You don't want to try and delay for too long, but the forward efforts of OCE Gaming might catch some of them out.
Yeah, I'm not too sure here. Like, it really could go either way. With the way this game's gone so far, I'd be inclined to side with T'Chinka here. We start to see the Zarya bubbles coming into play here. They're just kind of bubbling up Elite Ozzy and having him pressure on as Reinhardt. This was really where OC Gaming put on the great defense. Dropping Human Radio and Skelly and Gimpify. No healing. That's going to be some problems for Oceana pushing it this time.
Respect to Skarro, it appears that T'Chunka have followed my advice and focusing that Mercy a lot quicker. Skarro has gone for tried to kill Skellybones every fight, and almost every fight has succeeded, and that's what I like to see. If you can shut down that Mercy quick, then no res is going to come out for the attack inside of OCE Gaming.
Yeah, and the other thing worth noting here is we're in the sub 2 minute time already. There's a minute 45 left on the clock. Like, this is looking a little bit tight here. This push needs to come in pretty quick here and be pretty flawless. Elite Ozzy picking off the Lucio is going to be the good start. And Amber now to grab Landlord, but they need to grab the Mercy. Otherwise, that's going to happen. It's the rest. Elite Ozzy still grabbing more. And the Sobelstein's coming in here. He's doing all kinds of work. They have no healing on the defense, but it's Skarro and Landlord grabbing a couple quick. Landlord with a second. The other revive coming in here. And this is just such good delay from T'Chinka. They've got them into the minute range now. It is a minute 5 left. And they still haven't gotten the next point.
Yeah, in my opinion, Gibraltar gets harder to attack the further on in the map. Usually teams can push the second, third relatively quickly. So it's a really good sign for T'Chunka. They should be able to hold out even if they are to lose this point on the next fight.
Well, we have Human Radio trying to take out Hobbit here. Really not succeeding. Elite Ozzy is now here to support with his team.
Yeah, found that Hobbit's been quite good at jumping to people to avoid aggressors.
Not like, to mention, Reinhardt. He jumps to Skarro there, damage boosts him, and Skarro picks a kill. That's something we've seen a lot.
I mean, Skarro is such a good player, and when you jump to Skara, Skara will protect you.
Yeah, he's again grabbing his Nezahgu. He already picked up Gimpified earlier there. He's finally being pressured by Genji, but I don't think that's enough because this is almost done. We are almost over. 4, 3, 2, 1. A GG.
Yeah, and I think OCU Gaming will be eager to get the moral victory once again. Oh, Human Radio finally managed to kill Hobbit. Good on him.
Hey, finally did. He's only been trying for the last 2 minutes. Just kidding, I love you, Human Radio. Never forget. Yeah, it's Skaro. Like, easily the MVP of this match, and I'd probably say the best player in the server.
Heroes never die.
That's
well, other than that, me.
That said, I mean, Elite Aussie has once again kind of gone off as Reinhardt, but it's very hard as a Reinhardt to do much when you're dealing with such a good McCree. Skaro, like even in the post here, I'm pretty sure every kill on the kill feed is just being Skaro killing somebody, and we're looking at like 6 or 7 Ks. It's just kind of nutty, I think would be the only way I could describe it.
And the thing is, T'Chunkar are actually supporting him quite well. There's generally a player with him. Like there you saw, yes, he got picked off, but Soldier was right next to him. So if they had fought that a little better, they would have survived. Usually there's a Winston, a Mercy, or a Soldier with him at all times. And what that does is, when you do that for your star players, it just increases their potential to impact the game so much. Because one player on their own can't really win a game in Overwatch, but one player supported by their teammates, that can win a game. Like a man.
Yeah, that you are putting it in more of a live by the sword, die by the sword. As in, you know, Skaro started hot, he was being supported. If he started to whiff a little bit and started to kind of cool off, then, I mean, that can absolutely cripple your team. It'll either weaken your hold or delay your offense. And that's really the risk you put, putting so much faith in them. I hate to draw another Counter-Strike reference here, but it's very similar to Kenny S on Titans, which when Kenny S was firing on all cylinders, he would carry that team. When he was off his game, someone else didn't step up. That's when you had like the early exit Titans. And it's very similar here. If Skaro cooled off, he wasn't gonna, like, it would absolutely cost the team. As long as he was on today, he was playing like a Kenny S and just going absolute ham.
In saying that though, I don't want to discount Papi, because I think he's done a really good job. Additionally, I think if Skaro had been a bit weaker, I think the Slack would have been picked up.
Yeah, definitely a big impact player there, Papi. Like, we're not discounting anybody in the server. A lot of people have played really good games. Human Radio's even had some good moments. You know, we were talking about making fun of him a little bit for how hard a time he was having trying to kill that Genji. That Mercy as Genji. But, you know, he actually had some really, really strong moments. But...
And generally the reason why it was hard to kill the Mercy was because the Mercy was very well protected by the team. I like teams that kill their Mercy. Mercy is such an important player in this current meta.
It's the res. I mean, if they... Like, the only way they could even consider nerfing Mercy would be if you cap the res, and then that's just, like, not... That's just not a logical thing to nerf, I think. Of the game. So I really don't see a way you can get rid of Mercy as the centerpiece of so many of these games. Like, maybe reduce his, like, remove damage boost, maybe? But I'm pretty sure we're just gonna see for the entirety of Overwatch. Just the way the medic is a staple in TF2, Mercy's gonna be a staple in Overwatch.
I think the way, rather than nerfing Mercy, I think buffing the utility of other supports helps. Like, Zenyatta's Discord orb is really strong. And if other supports have utility, then it becomes a situational thing. Where it's like, okay, maybe for this fight we'll need a res, so let's play a Mercy. Maybe for this fight we'll need a Discord orb, let's play a Mercy. Or with Ana coming in, maybe we'll need that sleep dart, so let's bring in Ana.
At the same time, will anything really ever be more useful than a revive?
Well, if you're not getting wiped in the first place, you don't need a revive.
Maybe on King of the Hill maps, I could see that coming down to being the case, but I don't know. Yeah, I just feel like a revive is just such an impactful play. Like, if you use all your ults to kill like four people or three people or even five people, but leave the Mercy up, like, that absolutely erases those ults and you're back to a stalemate. Like, you gain no ground as long as Mercy's up and able to res, which is why it is the most crucial pick in a game of Overwatch right now. Hands down is the Mercy.
I think the exception would be if you wanted to play more of a split style. How Blizzard has nerfed Mercy is they nerfed the range of her resurrection. So if you're not dying as a team on one area, you can't all be resurrected. So maybe if a team was playing more of a split, like a flank and pick comp, then maybe other forms of utility would be more useful. I mean, I think Mercy is very strong at the moment, but I think there is the potential to make her not 100% pick, right? I mean, with the no hero limit, we saw double Lucio a lot on King of the Hill. And that was because he provided more utility, could boot people off, such and such. And I think that you can capture that even with the one hero limit and with Mercy being so dominant. I think Blizzard just needs to really take a good hard look at how other supports are working around each other.
Alright, well, enough about that kind of analysis of, you know, how they can buff in their supports, because we got something more important here. We are having interviews. That's right, people from the Masjid you just watched are coming in here to listen to me and Jammer talk and ask them questions. So far confirmed, I've got Deadly Bits coming in from OCE Gaming, Scarth from Tachanka, and I think it looks like Tachanka wants to have a second person come in. I'm not sure who that'll be, but for now we have Scarth here. How you doing, Scarth?
Hey, I'm good. How are you?
Pretty good, pretty good. Even better, having casted a great match. How do you feel coming in off the big win?
It's quite good. We didn't show up last week because we had a player fall asleep at his desk, so it's nice to play and win.
Yeah, the good old sleeping player is not necessarily what you want to have. I'm glad you guys could all make it in here. And I think we should have a few more coming in. So, first of all, like, let's just talk. Let's talk about the one that we just watched. Let's look back at Gibraltar, and you really just stonewalled them on that third point. What was really your big secret to that?
We wanted to deal with the Genji because he was like their best player, and he's annoying to deal with to begin with. So it was just suggested that I go Winston and we just run a defensive Reinhardt. Yeah, that's pretty much it.
And just before we go, I'll let Jamar ask the next question. But before we go to him, we have Elite Ozzy and Deadly Bits will be coming in for OCE. They're not here yet. So we're just with Scarth for now, but there will be others coming.
Would you be able to add my teammate, Landlord, to the permissions?
Spicy! Work your magic!
Well, while we're waiting for people to come in, me and Dreamboat were talking about the importance of Skaro in your roster, and we hypothesized that you guys work quite hard to work around him. Is that the case, or is it just that he works magic?
Yeah, pretty much. He'll usually just pick a high damage hitscan hero or Pharah, so Widow, Soldier, and the recent McCree buff, McCree as well. So he said he wanted to play McCree, and like that's fine. So we let him at McCree, and he wrecked Havoc, so that worked.
Yeah, one of the things which I was hoping for, which didn't happen, was I was hoping that he'd pull out that Widow. Why did you guys opt for the Kree instead of the Widow on that defense on Gibraltar?
Less volatile, and it gives you a stun against the Genji.
Well, now I'm sure Dreamboat has a few questions. Dreamboat, what would you like to ask?
I gotta go back to the opening map we had in Mbani, and it... You really opened up... Like, led to such a success for you, at least in my opinion, was... That opening point, you know, you stonewalled them when they tried to push into you on that point. When you walked in on your push, you walked in and killed them and got the cap on your first push. Were you expecting it to be that easy, or like what really for you guys kind of broke their hold, and what did they do wrong in your opinion?
I don't think Torbjorn is a very good hero at the moment. Landlord and Skarrow can both play him like pretty well because he's a hit scan hero, but I think the hero falls down quite a bit when you kill his turret, and we kill his turret right off the bat before he could even get close to a molten core. So they lost a big portion of their defense, and then we got Torbjorn on top of that, so he couldn't rebuild, and then they just sort of fell down around that.
So I noticed that you also opted for a Pharah on, I think it was Numbani. And I think, as you said, that helped with the Torbjorn, but what other reasons do you think there is to play a Pharah, bearing in mind that McCree's becoming so strong at the moment?
Escape route for Mercy. I often find that in public matchmaking, solo queue specifically, teams will often have issues dealing with a Mercy because Pharah provides such a strong escape mechanism for her to just be able to jump away and then to fly out of a Ziyarra ult or that sort of thing. I know Hitscan can still deal with her, but two targets in the air is a bit harder to deal with.
So we didn't see in Ana, or we didn't see the recently buffed D.Va. How do you feel about, I mean, the new hero and the changes that we, I mean, really haven't had that much of a time to adjust to?
I think it's okay. So about D.Va, her shield is really, really annoying now. I've been playing a little bit over the past 2 days since she got buffed. That shield is amazing.